Hello all, welcome to the next video on storage area networks. In this video we'll discuss chapter 4 of module 1 of your syllabus. The name of the topic is intelligent storage systems. So these are the chapter objectives. So we'll be discussing what is an intelligent storage system, so what are the components of intelligent storage system, the benefits of intelligent storage systems. We'll be explaining the intelligent cache algorithms and the protection. We'll try to understand what are the algorithms that will be used, as well as the implementation of intelligent storage systems, that is high-end storage array and mid-range storage array. So first let us try to answer a question: what is an intelligent storage system? Intelligent storage systems are RAID arrays that are highly optimized for input-output processing. So they have large amounts of cache for improving I/O performance, and they also have operating environments that provide intelligence for managing cache, array resource allocation, connectivity for heterogeneous hosts, and advanced array-based local and remote replication options. So they have operating environments that have intelligence to manage the cache efficiently. So they have the operating environment which can be used for array resource allocation, which can also be used for connectivity for heterogeneous hosts. Now what is this heterogeneous host? Different types of servers can use an intelligent storage system, or so intelligent storage system can cater to the needs of multiple different types of servers. Each may be running different operating systems or the different machines themselves, and they also provide the operating systems with support for advanced array-based local and remote replication options. So data may be replicated from one site to another. That will also supported by these intelligent storage systems. Let us look at the benefits of an intelligent storage system. Intelligent storage system provides several benefits over a collection of disks in an array or even a RAID array. So these are the benefits. First benefit is it offers increased capacity. So large amounts of data can be stored or retrieved using these intelligent storage systems at a faster speeds. Second benefit is improved performance. So the I/O request can be fulfilled very fast using these intelligent storage systems without any lag or without any disruption. It also offers easier data management. So large amounts of data from heterogeneous servers can be managed easily using these intelligent storage system. Fourth benefit is improved data availability and protection. It offers, or it makes sure that data is always available by the required hosts, or the host whichever wants to access the data. The intelligent storage system makes sure that the data is always accessible by that particular host, and also ensures that the data is protected. The next benefit is enhanced business continuity support. Businesses can rely on these intelligent storage systems for their operations, and they do not cause any disruption to the ongoing business operations. And lastly, improved security and access control. Since intelligent storage system handle and store large amounts of data, these data needs to be secured properly. That is offered, and that is a benefit of the intelligent storage system, which offers improved security and data access control. Now let us look at the components of an intelligent storage system. So this diagram represents the component, four major components of intelligent storage system. So intelligent storage system has a front end, a cache, a back end, and a bunch of physical disks. Let us first try to understand the working or the components of the front end of an intelligent storage system. So front end of an intelligent storage system consists of two components: the front end poles and the controllers. The front end controllers. The front end ports enable hosts to connect to the intelligent storage system. Each front end port has processing logic that executes appropriate transport protocol, such as SCSI, fiber channel or ISESI, FICON or FCOE for storage connections. These are the transport protocols that will be used for storing and retrieving the data. So these will be executed by the processing logic at the front end port. Redundant ports are provided on the front end for high availability in order to provide connectivity to larger number of hosts. The next component of the front end we have is the front end controllers. These front end controllers route data to and from the cache via the internal bus. When the cache receives the write data, the controller sends an acknowledgement message back to the host. Controllers also optimize I/O processing using command queuing algorithms. So that is the front end controllers. It optimizes the I/O processing by using command queuing algorithms. The next important component of an intelligent storage system is the cache. Let us see what this cache is. Cache is a semiconductor memory where data is placed temporarily to reduce the time required to service I/O requests from the host. It's a semiconductor memory which acts as a temporary location for the data in order to reduce the time that is required to service the I/O request from the host. Cache improves storage system performance by isolating hosts from the mechanical delays associated with physical disks, which are the slowest components of an intelligent storage system. So it actually helps in improving the storage system performance by isolating the hosts or the servers from the mechanical delays associated with the hard disk drives. Accessing data from cache takes less than a millisecond. It's a very fast memory. So data access will be in terms of milliseconds. Let us then understand the structure of a cache. As you can see in this particular diagram, cache is organized into pages or slots, which is the smallest unit of cache allocation. The smallest unit of cache allocation is called as a page. The size of each cache page is configured according to the application input-output size. Cache consists of two components, the data store and the tag RAM. The data store holds the data, while the tag RAM tracks the location of the data in the data store and in the disk. So tag RAM tracks the location of the data in the data store and in the disk, whereas the data store is basically a collection of data that is present in the cache. So that is the structure of the cache. Now let us look at the read operation. How is the read operation done or achieved using the cache? When a host issues the read request, the front-end controller accesses the tag RAM of the cache to determine whether the required data is available in cache. If the requested data is found in the cache, we term it as read cache hit or read hit, and data is sent directly to the host without any disk operation, so thereby speeding up the process of data retrieval or data reading. If the requested data is not found in the cache, it is called as cache miss, and the data must be read from the disk. In case of cache miss, the time required to process the read operation will be more, since the mechanical delays associated with the hard disk drive is also included. The backend controller accesses the appropriate disk and retrieves the requested data. Data is then placed in the cache and finally sent to the host through the front end controller. Cache misses increase the I/O response time. So if you want to improve the I/O response time, we need to make sure that the cache misses are reduced as much as possible. Let us try to understand the same using these animations here. So we have the host, the cache memory and the physical disk. Let us first see what do you mean by cache hit. A host requests for some data to be read. The front end controller checks if the data is present in the cache. If the data is present in the cache, we term it as cache hit, and data will be directly sent back to the host. That is called as read hit. Let's look at it once again. So data will be present in the cache. The data will be sent from the cache directly to the host. So it considerably increases the response time. Now let us look at the other scenario of cache miss. This was read hit. Now let us understand what you mean by cache miss. In cache miss, the host requests for some data to be read. The front end controller checks if the data is present in the cache. If the data is not present in the cache, data will be fetched from the physical disk. From the physical disk, it will be stored in the cache. From the cache, data will be sent back to the host. So the response time increases here. Let us observe it. So read request is received from the host. The cache will check if it contains the data. If the data is not present, data will be fetched from the physical disk, stored in the cache, and then sent back to the host. So these are the read operation with the cache, read hit and cache miss. So to improve the read performance, there are two techniques available. We call it as prefetch or read ahead techniques. First technique or one technique is called as fixed prefetch, and the second technique is called as variable prefetch, where frequently accessed data is fetched from the hard disk drive and stored into the cache memory. If the fixed blocks of data are stored or fixed amount of data is prefetched and stored, we call it as fixed prefetch, or else it's called as variable prefetch. Now there has to be some metric to measure or monitor the read performance of an intelligent storage system or read performance of a cache. So the read performance is measured in terms of read hit ratio or the hit rate, usually expressed as a percentage. This is the ratio of the number of read hits with respect to the total number of read requests. A higher read hit ratio improves the read performance. So to say that cache is having a better read performance, it should have a high read hit ratio. Now let us look at the write operation with the cache. We just discussed the read operation with the cache. There are two operations there, or two scenarios. One is called as read hit and one more is called as cache miss. Similarly, in write operation we have three techniques. We call it as write aside cache, write through cache, and write back cache. In write back cache, data is placed in cache and an acknowledgement is sent to the host immediately. Right? Later, data from several writes are committed to the disk, that is restaged to the disk. Response times are much faster. This write back cache is used to improve the response times. Uncommitted data in the cache is at the risk of loss if the cache failure occurs. Since cache is a semiconductor memory, or it retains data only as long as the power supply is present. So once the power supply is switched off, it may lose the data. So in write back cache, uncommitted data to the disk is at the risk of being lost. So the next write operation we have is called as write through cache. In write through cache, data is placed in the cache and immediately returned to the disk, and then an acknowledgement will be sent to the host. So here there is a very low loss risk of data loss, but the disadvantage is it takes much time to complete the write operation. Response time is much longer because the data has to be returned or committed to the disk, and only then the acknowledgement has been given to the host. So that is write back cache and write through cache. We have one more term called as write aside cache, where the cache may be bypassed. That is typically used for very large writes of data. If data that needs to be written is very large, in that case write aside cache, write aside size may be used. But in write back cache, the advantage is faster response time. Disadvantage is there is more risk of data loss. Data present in the cache may be lost. In write through cache, it's the reverse of that. Low data loss risk, but response time is much longer. Now let us try to understand these operations again using a simulation here. Let us first try to understand what do you mean by write through cache. In write through cache, the write request from the host is written in the cache, is stored in the cache and immediately committed to the disk. Only after the data has been committed to the disk, an acknowledgement will be given back to the host. Hence, response time is longer, but risk of data loss is less in case of write through cache. So response time is longer because data needs to be fetched, data needs to be stored, committed to the disk, returned to the disk, and then an acknowledgement will be given to the host. In write back cache, it's the reverse case. So whenever there is a write request from the host, data will be stored in the cache and immediately an acknowledgement will be given. Later, after several writes, data will be returned to the disk. Right? So read request, write request, data will be returned to the cache, stored in the cache, second store, third write request. After some time, all these writes will be committed to the disk. Okay? So as we can see here, immediately after data is stored, an acknowledgement will be given back to the host. So faster response time. The demerit is whatever data that is present in the cache may be lost if the cache failure occurs. That is write through cache and write back cache. Now let us look at what we mean by cache implementation. Cache can be implemented as either dedicated cache or global cache. In dedicated cache, separate sets of memory locations are reserved for reads and writes. Okay, cache is divided into two parts. One area of cache or one set of memory location is used only for reads, and one more set is used only for writes in case of dedicated cache. In global cache, both reads and writes can use any of the available memory addresses. So two types of cache implementation, please remember, global cache and dedicated cache. Dedicated cache, separate sets of memory locations are reserved for reads and writes. In global cache, both reads and writes can use any of the available memory addresses. So while looking at the cache management algorithms, there are, it uses two techniques. One is least recently used and the other one is most recently used. In least recently used, or LRU, cache discards the least recently used data. Data which was very old, that data that was not used will be discarded. Whereas in case of MRU, the most recently used technique, it discards most recently used data, assuming that data which was most recently used will not be used for some point of time in the future, will not be used immediately. So keeping that in mind, MRU will be implemented. So you can just observe the animation here. A new data comes and the old data, oldest data will be removed, so thereby freeing the cache for storing the new data. The cache utilization level drives the modes of flushing. So clearing the contents of the cache and dumping these contents, or flushing this content to the disk drive, we call it as flushing. There are three modes of cache flushing. First mode is called as idle flushing. The second mode is called as high watermark flushing. And the third mode is called as forced flushing. So before that, remember, there are two levels that are used to monitor the cache utilization. It's called as high watermark level and low watermark level. In case of idle flushing, so it occurs continuously at a modest rate when the cache utilization level is between the high and low watermark levels. In case of high watermark level flushing, it is activated when cache utilization hits the high watermark. The storage system dedicates some additional resources to flushing. This type of flushing has minimal impact on host I/O processing. So whenever the cache utilization is between the high watermark level and low watermark level, if the contents of the cache are cleared, it is termed as idle flushing. If the contents of the cache are flushed once the cache utilization level reaches high watermark, that's called as high watermark level flushing. The third mode we have is something called as forced flushing. Forced flushing occurs in the event of large I/O bursts when cache reaches 100% of its capacity, which significantly affects the I/O response time. In forced flushing, 30 pages are forcibly forced to the disk. The forced flushing occurs when the cache utilization has reached its 100% of its storage capacity, or 100% of its capacity, and the entire contents of the cache will be flushed to the disk drive. So watermarking is used to manage peak I/O request bursts through flushing and destaging. It's also used for tracking the maximum performance and to provide headroom in write cache for I/O bursts. Let us again look at the different modes of cache flushing using this animation. In case of idle flushing occurs when the cache utilization is between high watermark level and low watermark level. As you can see, it occurs when the utilization of the cache is between HWM and LWM, that is high watermark level and low watermark. In case of high watermark flushing, it occurs once the cache utilization reaches the high watermark level, then the content of the cache will be flushed to the disk. In case of forced flushing, it occurs only when the cache utilization has reached its full capacity. Once the cache utilization has reached 100%, the entire contents of the cache, the dirty pages present in the cache, will be committed or flushed to the hard disk. Let us look at the next topic, cache data protection. Whatever data that is present in the cache, which is a temporary data, in which the data is stored temporarily, should be protected against power failures or other cache failures. There are two techniques that is used to protect the data. First technique is called as cache mirroring. Each write to the cache in case of cache mirroring is held in two different memory locations on two independent memory cards. Rather than relying on just one cache card or memory card, here every write from the host is held in, or every write to the cache is held in two different caches or two different memory cards. So even if one of the card cache fails, data will be available in the surviving cache. Just like what we discussed mirroring case of read, so here we have mirroring of the cache using two independent memory cards. Second technique for data protection in cache is called as cache vaulting. Here cache is provided with an additional power backup. in case the primary power backup fails. Okay, in case the primary data fails, in case the primary power supply to the cache fails, so the additional power backup will make sure data present in the cache is not lost. That is cache vaulting. Now let us look at the next component of the intelligent storage system, that is the backend. Similar to the front end, the backend also has backend ports and backend controllers. Backend ports provide connectivity to connect the backend to the physical disks or array of storage, whereas backend controllers may perform certain operations such as checking for such as error correction and so on, and checking data integrity and so on. The next component of intelligent storage system is the physical disks. The physical disks actually store the data that is received from the host, but it is also used to fetch the data that is required by the host. Physical disk may implement certain data protection techniques such as the RAID in order to protect the data.